Before I start my paper, I would like to use this opportunity to inform the people who are interested in Arabic studies about an event in our university, because this year is 200 years of the birth of one of the founders of Arabic studies in Russia, who was Egyptian by origin. He was a sheikh, the Jamiat al-Azhar, and then he became a professor in St. Petersburg University. His name is Muhammad Ayat al-Tamtali. Unfortunately, nowadays he's not well known outside Russia, and we organized a conference this year dedicated to him. And I just would like you to inform about this really very important scholar who was, according to a famous Arabist of 19th century name, the best specialist in Arabic literature and language. He was very well known in Europe in 19th century, but now unfortunately he's a little bit forgotten. So what I would like to do, I pass a book of our conference and an Arabic translation of the book by academician Krachkovsky about Muhammad al-Tamtari, Billugh al-Arabiya. So you can just have a look and to get some impression about this very important Arabic scholar, unfortunately a little bit forgotten. For instance, such Egyptian scholar as Tahtali is very well known in the West because he produced a description of Paris in 19th century. But our Sheikh Muhammad al-Tamtari produced a similar description of Russia in St. Petersburg. This book also was published in Amman some 15 years ago. So it's a wonderful story about Arabs understanding Europe, and it's important for multicultural studies. So I just want to attract your attention to this person, and perhaps somebody will be interested in it. So I just pass information about this person. This is, by the way, it's his portrait in Russia in the 19th century. And this is our book, and this book about him. So just it will be just fair to remember this wonderful scholar at such a good occasion. And last point, Krachkovsky wrote a book about him. And by the way, in the book of our conference, there are the pictures of his tomb. And what's interesting, his tomb in St. Petersburg is among most precious things in St. Petersburg together with state hermitage. So it's a list of the historical places in Russia. Mm-hmm. So in Russia he is very well respected. Well, and last point, this year we started a project in our university dedicated to electronic publication of the collection of Arabic manuscripts collected by Sheikh al-Tamtari, and gave it to our university, and it's the best of our collection of Arabic manuscripts. And our purpose is to produce publication in electronic form, so to make it available for scholars all around the world. And why I want to attract your attention for another minute. Because now technically we came to some stage when it's possible to publish Arabic manuscripts in electronic form. We have thousands of Arabic manuscripts all around the world, and now in theory they can be available in electronic form. So I'm absolutely sure that in some years we'll come to this problem, and we will have to find standard ways, standard rules of description of those manuscripts all around the world. In order to make these collections searchable in electronic form, in order to make them available, because now there are many publications, but they have no general system. So what we do hope that our project will be one of the first milestones on the very important road to publish Arabic manuscript text. I just show you this system, you know, we describe the manuscripts, you know, the titles. Then we describe the system, it's described as manuscripts, you know, a paper, boundings, and all this information about the manuscript. Then information about actual works published there. So it's information about the titles. Then you come to information about the author. And then there is a system of search and so on. So if somebody will be interested, I can later show you individually. And I hope that if some of you will start similar projects in some future, we will be happy to discuss possibilities and our experience in this respect. So thank you about taking some of your time because of this important scholar and our project, and I come to my paper in this session. The subject of my paper is hunting Arabian Felix. Politics of the Byzantines, Sasanians, Ethiopians, and Arabs in South Arabia in the 6th century. The history of the South Arabia in the period under consideration was tightly related to the history of the great powers of the time, the Byzantines, the Sasanians, and in this great game, all neighboring lesser powers were involved, including Himyarit Yemen, Aksum Kingdom in Ethiopia, and early Arabic states and tribes in Arabia. And the highest point of this confrontation corresponds to the 6th century. These two superpowers fought over political, territorial, and economical, commercial issues. Political fighting was concentrated in Upper Mesopotamia and Caucasus, where a number of Byzantine Persian wars took place. The Arabs in Arabia Deserta were also involved in this struggle via satellite states of Ghassanians and Lakhmids, on the borders of Byzantine and Iran, respectively. As for South Arabia, it was not a subject of territorial expansion. Actually, after an attempt made by Elius Gallus in 24 BC, there were no attempts to conquer South Arabia. It proved to be virtually impossible task. But South Arabia was a crucial area in the international transit trade, which is known by the name of Silk Road, or actually for this period we are talking about southern maritime branch of the Silk Road. These times, because of this reason, one of priorities of Byzantine politics in the East was establishing the control over South Arabia as an important crossroad of this oriental terrain. I'd like to explain why this subject was selected for my speech. Professor Christidis, who is organizer of many conferences in the field, complained several times about Greeks of the period being unable anymore to arrange maritime trade, maritime travels to India, and that Byzantine of the time actually failed in finding alternative routes to the east. This opinion, which is, of course, existed in scholarly literature, and it has its own reasons, but what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to specify in which respects Byzantines failed in their attempt to establish a route to India via Saudi Arabia. What exactly was the purposes of Byzantine policy? So it will be possible to say, was it really successful or really failed? Well, it's just to find answers to this question, we have to specify which aspects of, let us say, Oriental policy of the Byzantine Empire took place and how they were performed. The first task of Byzantine Eastern policy was fighting their major enemy, Sasanians. Hence, the need of allies and such a possible allies were Arabs of Arabia Deserta and further to the south, Aksum Kingdom in Ethiopia and Himyar in South Arabia. Second direction of Byzantine policy was Oriental trade. When we are talking about Oriental trade or trade to India, this also has to be specified. First, there was standard Oriental trade of it was so-called instance road from South Arabia and Somalia. Connections with India, it was trade of spices, precious stone and so on. This traditional trade existed from ancient times, but in the 6th century a new aspect of this Oriental trade appeared. It was the trade related to the trade of Chinese silk, more exact of raw silk, so-called metaxa, which was at the basis of Byzantine production of textiles. The wars with Iran made it difficult to get silk via traditional land silk roads. Byzantines tried to find their way to the silk via India. That's why Yemen became so important in Byzantine politics. I don't come to the details of this fight. We know it very well. We know the story of Byzantine embassies to Aksum in relation to Abdu'l-Nawas policy of establishing Judaism in Yemen and persecutions, severe persecutions of the Christians in Yemen. Byzantine was successful in organizing, I would say, worldwide struggle against Abdu'l-Nawas, and eventually in 525 he was deposed and killed by Aksum, king of Ethiopia, and pro-Byzantine regime was established in Yemen. This became a very important victory of the Byzantium, and Byzantium started an attempt to perform their Oriental policy. They tried push Aksumites and Himyarites to trade with India. and to buy silk in India and bring it to the Byzantine merchants, so to avoid using Iranian route. It was okay. The result of this policy was not successful because of the reason that Iranian merchants were very well established in India, and Himyarites could not, and Aksumites could not take this from them. So, from this point of view, Byzantine policy was a failure. But on the other hand, they managed to arrange land trade of incenses and all these traditional ways of bringing Oriental food. And from this respect, it was successful enough. So, what Byzantines managed to do? They managed to arrange this trade because it was not bringing goods from one side of the world to another. There were many stages, and Byzantines managed to provide functioning of this Arabian stage of trade very successfully, and until the end of the 6th century functioned. Of course, finally, the Iranians managed to conquer Yemen and establish their rule at the end of the 6th century, but it was so-called another story. As by this time, Byzantines managed to start producing silk in their own territory. And alternatively, they found some way via the Turks.
Thank you, Mr. Alexander.
So, in general, I'm finished. So, in general, it was
part of the failure
and part of the success.
So, for the